The need to grow to the limits of our capacities, to become what we potentially are. I think of the extraordinary line which Mallarmé wrote in his sonnet about Edgar Allan Poe, where he says, tel qu'en lui-même enfin l'éternité le change. As eternity changes him into himself, we don't have to wait for eternity. It is possible to become ourselves in the fullest ego-transcending form, even in this life.
In fact, there's something very unworldly about this man who has concluded that intelligence and virtue are the ends of life. His eyes have that abstracted, gelatinous look of the nearly blind. And altogether, he would be a rather forbidding skeleton of a man if he were not so intensely gentle.
This is a documentary. This is primarily a question. This is many and diverse contradictory desires. This is a guarantee of truth. If I say that Aldous Huxley wrote, but the only hope for the world of time lies in being constantly drenched by that which lies beyond time. What is being repeated is the asking for your remembrance of your own nature. And from this interrogation, our communality can be born and then lived as realization and compassion. This is not a proper documentary. The project is not about the chronology of Huxley's life, but about his ideas. Gene Houston, Senior Advisor to the United Nations on Matters of Human Development.
Aldous Huxley loved Homer, and I think he'd be vastly amused, wherever he is, maybe right here, if we began by invoking his spirit in the same way that Homer, in the opening lines of the Odyssey, invokes the story of Odysseus. And the lines, translated in English, are, sing in me, muse, and through me tell the story of the man of many ways. And yet, Aldous, being a student of languages, would have probably enjoyed it if we all did it together in ancient Greek. And I don't mean any piddling Platonic Greek. I mean Homeric Greek, which would have sounded bardically like, Handra moyenepe, musa politropu. So let's all do it, if you'd all stand up. We're going to invoke the spirit in ancient Greek of the man of many ways. I'll give you the lines. Andra moyenepe, there was a lot of expression. Handra moyenepe, musa. Sing in me, muse, and through me tell the story of the man of many ways. Today we sing the many ways of the man who was Aldous Leonard Huxley.
We have to attack on all the fronts. I mean, just as we have to attack the individual human problem on its psychological, its physiological, and its social front, so we have to attack the general social problem on its organizational front and also on the front of individual training and education. I mean, I think it's absurd to say that we can only do one thing rather than another. We must do both. I mean, nothing short of everything is ever enough.
He begins as a satirist, he ends as a prophet. He comes on the scene as a social critic and leaves it as a social artist. Between the novels Chrome Yellow and Island, there is the journey of the son of the intellectual aristocracy of England, the grandson of Thomas Huxley, the great social philosopher and scientist, the brother of biologist Julian Huxley, the grandnephew of the novelist Matthew Arnold.
I was born in the brave new world of November 3rd, 1957. The same day that a half-ton Sputnik 1 rocket carrying a dog was put into orbit by the Soviets. The dog, Laika, was kept alive for 10 days, proving that life could survive prolonged weightlessness in the other then unknown conditions of outer space. My parents were considering calling me Sputnik number 1. I would have been the first space age punk.
The abolition of free will by methodical conditioning, the servitude made acceptable by regular doses of chemically induced happiness, the orthodoxies drummed in by nightly courses in sleep teaching, advertising, soma, Prozac, music television. Everyone belongs to everyone else.
The whole history of recent times in relation to science and technology shows that if you plant the seed of applied science or technology, it proceeds to grow, and it grows according to the laws of its own being. And the laws of its being are not necessarily the same as the laws of our being.
Technology accelerates our progress, but this is often only a progress towards acceleration.
You all remember, I suppose, that beautiful and inspired saying of our Ford's, "History is bunk." He waved his hand, and it was as though with an invisible feather whisk he had brushed away a little dust, and the dust was Harappa, was Earth, the Chaldees, some spider webs, and they were Thebes, and Babylon, and Knossos, and Mycenae. Whisk, whisk. And where was Odysseus? Where was Job? Where were Jupiter, and Gautama, and Jesus? Whisk. The place where Italy had been was empty. Whisk. The cathedrals. Whisk, whisk. King Lear and the thoughts of Pascal. Whisk.
What I may call the messages of Brave New World, that it is possible to make people contented with their servitude. I think this can be done. I think it has been done in the past, but and I think it could be done even more effectively now, because you can provide them with bread and circuses, and you can provide them with endless amounts of distractions and propaganda.
I first read Huxley's Brave New World when I was 9 years old. The year was 1967.
Was the novel science fiction or a portrait of the world that I was going to eventually have to find my way in? The horrific vision of voluntary acquiescence to the solidarity of a world civilization bent on the twin directives of thoughtless pleasures and ordered efficiency. A thoroughly narcissistic society without an aspiration towards beauty or grace and without the troubles of the contemplation of a soul.
October the 21st, 1949. Dear Mr. Orwell, the nightmare of 1984 is destined to modulate into the nightmare of Brave New World. The change will be brought about as a result of a felt need for increased efficiency. Thank you once again for the book. Yours sincerely, Aldous Huxley.
Impersonal forces of population and over-organization and social engineers trying to direct these forces are pushing us into a new medieval system. Now, what should you mean by that?
Well, I meant that in this utopian novel of mine, Brave New World, I describe not exactly a medieval system, but a kind of scientific caste system. And that it was controlled not by force, but by manipulation of human minds and bodies. And I would think that, it's true that there are impersonal forces pushing us in the direction of central totalitarian control. And also, what is to me very interesting, it looks as though the totalitarian regimes of the future will not be based upon terror, because they will have other means. These means now at present described as brainwashing and propaganda, which will be much more efficient and much more economical than
and pleasurable
force, and more pleasurable to those who undergo them. Because, I mean, there are techniques available at present which do seem to duplicate some of the techniques that I invented.
In 1936, when you wrote Brave New World, there was a kind of certainly implicit pessimism here about the future, about man.
Yes, and unfortunately, of course, I put all the events in Brave New World in the 7th century after Ford, and a great deal of it has come true within 27 years, or whatever the period is since I wrote it. I'm often very alarmed at what has already happened in the way of the prophecies being fulfilled. And I do think that we seem to be moving in that direction, that there seem to be a number of impersonal forces pushing that way and a number of technological discoveries which can be used to accelerate the movement in that direction.
Do you hold any fears that some future dictator, to use the term, might use such things as mass communication, the newly discovered drugs, subliminal suggestion, what's called brainwashing, all of these new motivational research, all these new techniques for gaining consent?
I'm quite sure they can do it. After all, it's, to a considerable extent, it's been done. I mean, the brainwashing is already a fact, and the point is that technology is continuously advancing. I was talking, for example, yesterday with the man who did the much of the basic research work in this subliminal projection. He said at the moment it presents no great threat, but he said technology is on the march, and we shall undoubtedly have within a few years extremely effective methods for using this and for persuading people to do things without their knowledge.
You've been currently working, as I understand, on some articles on the new threats to liberty that grow out of these attempts to control society.
What I'm trying to persuade people is that they should think in advance of what's going to happen. I mean, the trouble one sees this again and again, that people have allowed themselves to be taken by surprise by the advances in technology. There's really no reason why we should be. I mean, given the available evidence and given a certain amount of imagination, you can foresee some of the consequences of this, and if you foresee, you can do something to mitigate the effects.
Hysterically definitive, thoroughly logical, repeated chants of zeros and ones gives you any number of numbers to a practical infinity of mathematically seasonable strawberry fields. The binary diffuses an exactitude of similitude, reigns an illusion of perfectitude through continual electronic switches, allowing and disallowing in algorithmic procedural commands. So what does this reflect but an inhuman patience, an Alhambraic monotony of labyrinthine design? Terminal language, program language. The adjustable face of grammar, the originating of human intelligence, replaced by the nervous excitation of an immaculate mask of distinct memory but no resemblances.
The face of the human is our first human word. The face speaks profoundly of the differences among humans and of the sameness of humans. I am a white male filmmaker. My actor, David Odhiambo, transfigures my speech, colors my words with his own unique intonation. In cyberspace, there is no need for a face and its mark of mortality. In the code of the binary is the metaphoric Rosetta Stone to a language beyond our own humanity. This is its promise and its horror. That is the today of our brave new world.
I mean, hence this sense which so many people have, and which I think one sees in so many societies, this sense that man is being subjected to his own inventions, that he is now the victim of his own technology and the victim of his own applied science, instead of being in control of it.
Where the caustic history of capitalization fuses in our bodies, the welt of greed erupts as our primary encouragement and reason to be.
Is the problem, I mean, I think that this is perhaps one of the major problems of our time. How do we make use of this thing? I mean, after all, this was stated in the gospel. The Sabbath was made for man and not man for the Sabbath. And in the same way, technology was made for man and not man for technology. But unfortunately, the development of recent social and scientific history has created a world in which man seems to be made for technology rather than the other way around.
What program are you watching? The program is watching you. Whose program are you acting in? Whose program is suppressing you? Democracy and the possible human is subsumed under a banner of exploitation. Progress then is nothing more than technological five and dime gimmicks, a further enslavement. An acquaintance of mine had a dream the other night. The promise of the perfect thrusts a hollow shaft of impregnable light, and in whispered, seductive, technological jargon, camouflages its hostile, virulent virus. She found on her kitchen table, in amongst the breadcrumbs, a thin, shiny plastic object. She said she was strangely attracted to it. It didn't occur to her to question the purpose of the object. Perhaps it was in its obliqueness unanswerable.
You like the kitchen, perhaps?
Perhaps. Anyway, brushing aside the folds of her nightgown, she used the object to insert into her vagina, masturbating with it. Of course, this object must have been a future life form infiltrating the dream dimensional of the earthly sphere. Who knows? And who knows how many humans it had sex with that night, or what prodigy it predicted with its action? But notice its resemblance to computer diskette, a thin square wafer, the Eucharist of our processing era. The era of carbon chemistry life is drawing to a close on Earth, and a new era of silicone-based life, indestructible, immortal, infinitely expendable, is beginning.
A leading figure in the comparative philosophy of religion, Dr. Houston Smith, visiting professor at the University of California, Berkeley.
Without much trouble, my nomination of Aldous Huxley succeeded. Huxley arrived at MIT at exactly the moment that Timothy Leary arrived at Harvard, having taken some mushrooms on the side of a swimming pool in Cuernavaca en route, so they got together. He gave a series of lectures in Kresge Auditorium, and at one point they grew so heavily that they had to, the Boston police force, traffic force, had to augment their staff on Wednesday evenings because of the traffic jams that were being created across the Charles River in Cambridge. when I remarked what a tribute to Aldous, what a tribute that was, he characteristically passed it off. He said, it's because I'm so old. He was in his 60s then. He said, I've become like Anne Hathaway's cottage. He said, if I live to be 100, I will be like Stonehenge.
A rationalist and a skeptic of the first order who early on took the role of detached observer, he set about acquiring leaky margins to the universe and courted the ways and means to become transparent to transcendence. This was Aldous Huxley. Looking at the novels, we see the satirist and the social critic in those early novels, chrome yellow, antique, those barren leaves, point counterpoint, books rich in ironies, showing the contradictions of the human condition.
The origin of the Huxley name is linked to my own paternal name, Hockenhall. The family seat was Hockenhall, about 6 miles east of Chester, England. The family held it from the time of William the Conqueror until shortly after the middle of the 1700s. At the time of Richard I, there was one Swanista Hockenhall, who was given a fiefdom by the abbot and convent of St. Werburgh. He lived in a manor named Huxley. Of the grandsons of the Swanist, the eldest kept the manor and name of Hockenhall. The younger one took his name from the fife, Huxley. But the historians of Cheshire records the fact that owing to the respectability of the names, they were unlawfully assumed by divers losers and lewd fellows of the baser sort. And my father also used to declare that he was certain the legitimate owners of the name were far too sober and respectable to produce such a reprobate as himself, and one of these losers must be his progenitor. Once when my brother was in Chicago, he checked a phone book and found one Maddie Hockenhall. He phoned her up and told her who he was. She then asked him if he was a white man. She was the widow of a black man whose family got the name as slaves of Hockenhalls who had settled in Georgia. In Huxley's novel, Point Counterpoint, the thoroughly modern material girl who has embraced a society that equates speed with progress and the personal ego with the omnipotence of God explains her rationale for living without commitment. When I was about at the halfway point producing this film, I was betrayed in love. The experience was a repeat of what Huxley had written in his novel. This is a film within a film, another point to counterpoint.
One after another. Without a break in between. Since I was 17. You know, and I've always been attracted to older men. Well, I always ended up in relationships with older men, because I guess I thought they had something to teach me, and it's becoming increasingly more difficult. You know, I gave them my youth and they gave me their knowledge, although I don't know how much they really knew. They certainly didn't know anything about me. And, you know, it's like I feel harnessed, you know, trapped. And even though I'm in a situation that I created, I'm really angry at them. And I have to get out. And I do.
What's your attitude towards, say, contemporary woman, particularly a North American woman?
Well, I mean, to start with, is there such a thing as woman with a large W? I've never met it. I've met a lot of women who seem to be extremely different one from another, just as I've met a lot of men who seem to be extremely different one from another. I mean, can one really generalize?
You suggested that the world seems perhaps more than duly preoccupied with the female bosom. Is this a part of this whole theory?
This is certainly one of the fashions. I mean, if you look back on history, you can see this. There's a sort of curve of bosom consciousness and non-bosom consciousness. I mean, for example, in the 17th century, and if you look at the portraits of Velázquez, the ladies have no bosoms, and they were girl children were wrapped up in lead corsets so that their bosom couldn't develop at all. And then you've got in the 18th century the exact opposite of this, and we happen to be in now in one of these exuberant phases.
She's constantly telling me for 3 years that she loves me. You know, I'm the guy. Right, that's it. And everything is perfect.
Perfect. You should never say perfect, Andrew, because it never is.
Yeah, no, but this was perfect. Everybody knew it. And then she dumps me for a television producer. Right? A Generation X, a cultural variety show, something. And so I say, okay, fine, you know, but can I have my place back? She'd been living in my place while I was away, and we were supposed to live together when I got back home. But she says, no, I can't have my place back. She put her name on my lease. It was just crazy. And so, and then the contract fell through in New York, and I'm totally out of money. I have to sell my car to get back to Vancouver. But the day I'm about to leave, the guy phones me, and he says, I can't buy your car because my dad has to have his feet cut off.
Cut off his feet?
His feet. The sheer horror and stupidity and randomness of the world.
A section derived from Point Counterpoint.
You didn't answer my question. Do you love me?
Sam.
Why did you spend a year with me?
Why? Because it amused me. Because I wanted to. Isn't that fairly obvious?
Without loving?
Why must you always bring in love?
How can you leave it out?
If I can have what I want without it, why should I put it in? And besides, one doesn't put it in. It happens to one. Or perhaps it never happens. I don't know. Anyhow, what's one to do in the interval? You were amusing once.
Not to mention the others.
Idiot. Instead of being grateful for what you had. I haven't time for your nonsense.
What did I have? What did I have?
I'm not going to change my lifestyle for you or anyone else. The fall was all right when people lived slowly, but it's too ponderous nowadays. There's no room for it.
Not even for the heart?
Well, perhaps it's a pity, but you can't get something for nothing. If you like speed, if you want to cover ground, you can't have luggage. The thing is to know what you want and be ready to pay for it.
I'd prefer to be human.
Quoting Huxley on Aesthetics, 1931.
I have never had the smallest ambition to be a classic of any kind, whether neo, paleo, proto, or eo, not at any price. For to begin with, I have a taste for the lively, the mixed, and the incomplete in art, preferring it to the universal and the chemically pure. In the second place, I regard the classical discipline, with its insistence on elimination, concentration, simplification, as being, for all the formal difficulties it imposes on the writer, essentially an escape from actual reality. In the 30s, with the ever-increasing threat of warfare, Huxley turned his pen to writing pacifist articles. It was also at about this time that Huxley began training as a student of the Alexander technique, a a series of psychophysical exercises concerning mindful attention, body structure, posture, and gravity.
Work on what we call the head-neck-back relationship. That's it, yeah, good. Sense, you could say that the goal of upright stature is one of length. And where I've got my hand right here, at the base of your skull, that's the advanto-occipital joint. So in a sense, that's the top end of yourself. Everything sort of comes up. All the musculature kind of attaches around that area of yourself, and that's where the...
PBC broadcast, 1934.
Man is a profoundly social being and derives enormous satisfactions from feeling himself at one with the other members of his group. War strengthens all the ties that bind the individual to the group, and heightens his sense of group solidarity to the pitch of intoxication. The barbarian and the unconscious sadist are strong within us. So strong that even in peacetime, newspaper proprietors find it worth their while to devote a large proportion of their space to the description of crimes. In wartime, half of every morning's paper deals with slaughter, and most of the rest consists of incitements to hatred on the one hand, and to group solidarity on the other. The first condition of war is that the population of the planet should be divided into organized groups, and that each individual should be conscious of his own group's separateness from and superiority to all other groups. The patriot is allowed to indulge with a good conscience in vanity and hatred. Vanity in regard to his own group, hatred in regard to all other groups.
The talk you've just heard was one of a series, The Causes of War. And the speaker was Mr. Aldous Huxley.
1936.
Sir, we have been keeping an eye on you for some time past and have decided that you cannot be allowed to go on in your present disloyal and treacherous way. We give you fair warning. If you make any more of your dirty pacifist speeches, we shall deal with you as you deserve. It is announced that you are speaking tonight in Battersea. We shall be there. So we advise you, if you value your yellow skin, to keep away. You do not deserve this warning, but we want to behave sportingly, even towards a skunk like you. Yours faithfully, a group of patriotic Englishmen.
1956. The notion that one can educate young people without making any serious attempt to educate the psychophysical instrument by means of which they do all their learning and living seems on the face of it radically absurd. Looking back over my own years of schooling, I can see the enormous deficiencies of a system which could do nothing better for my body than military drill and compulsory football, nothing better for my character than prizes, punishments, sermons and pep talks, and nothing better for my soul than a hymn or bedtime.
The word freedom perhaps is too vague a term in this sort of context. I think what we have to ask is what sort of a social pattern and what sort of a political regime is best calculated to help the individuals within the society to realize the maximum extent of their desirable potentialities. I mean, it's quite obvious that most of us are functioning at about 10% of capacity, and it wouldn't it be nice if we could function at 20%. As a matter of fact, I've just finished a kind of utopian fantasy, which is the opposite of Brave New World, which is about a society in which a serious effort is made to help its members to realize their desirable potentialities. And I've gone into, I mean, this is an attempt to write what may be called a practical utopia. Nothing is easier, of course, than to enunciate ideals and to say, well, wouldn't it be nice if everybody were good and kind and loving, etc., etc. Of course it would be very nice, but the point is How do you implement these ideals? How do you fulfill your good social and psychological intentions? And when you come down to this problem, you see it's a very complex problem of organizing family life, organizing education, organizing sexual life, organizing social and economic life. I mean, there are endless factors involved in this. And to try to work out what all these factors should be is a, I must say, I found a very interesting job.
There comes a change. A threshold is crossed, and we are given novels that speak to a big turnaround, what the Greeks called an enantiodromia, a conversion or opening to a citizenry in a universe larger than his previous aspirations, more complex than all our dreams. Consider Eyeless in Gaza, a book of the mid-30s, a strange, overwritten book that marks a point of no return. No longer could he just parody or maintain a position of disenchantment, for he had moved beyond the appearance of things to the pursuit of the essence behind them. Contained in that book are the ideas that emerged and are developed in most of his later books, the belief in a spiritual reality underlying the phenomenal world, and that this reality is there to be experienced by anyone willing to do the work of clearing the mind to receiving it. A conviction that social changes come about by changing individuals who compose societies. And from this, then, these extraordinary books then emerged after many a summer dies a swan, an extraordinary book about rejuvenation. Time must have a stop, consciousness after death.
1929. Huxley picks up Henry Ford's My Life and Works in a ship's library between Java and Borneo.
In these seas, and to one fresh from India and Indian spirituality, Indian dirt and religion, Henry Ford seems a greater man than Buddha. In Europe, on the other hand, and still more, no doubt, in America, the way of Gautama has all the appearance of the way of salvation. One is all for religion until one visits a really religious country. There, one is all for drains, machinery, and the minimum wage. To travel is to discover everybody is wrong.
Well, I would call it a kind of attempt to understand things. I mean, this is what I feel about myself. I mean, I've tried to learn all through my life as much as possible, and I've sort of tried to jot down what I feel I've learned, and I think consequently there may seem to be a number of inconsistencies in what I've written, but this I hope is due to the fact that I've begun to learn new things and been able to look at things in a different way. And if the work has any value, it represents the record of a long learning process.
Again, I don't think there's any incompatibility between science and mysticism.
No, no.
I mean, it's the only form of, I mean, this kind of imminent religion is the only form of religion in which there is no conflict at all that I can see between science and religion.
Was there any person or any book or any experience in your own life that seemed to turn you towards making this this synthesis?
In the 30s, I had a period of depression and insomnia and so on, where I suppose one would call it a kind of crisis in my life. And it was at that time that I became especially concerned with this, the whole sort of philosophic problem of imminent religion.
Now, the light experience is of several kinds. And the great pattern that is of the coding contains whirlwinds of spacious energy which give the appearance and feel of solid matter, and put into these fields a cosmic information system, I mean, one that connects quadrillions of miles of resonance instantly, so that anything is known to the whole immediately. Well, you then place it with this next life, which we meet as sentient forms that can evolve to more complex and conscious entities. And from this life, then let us emerge in joy.
Now, the life experience has several kinds. It's the experience which is recorded in a great deal of the literature of what may be called undifferentiated light, just an enormous burst of light, unembodied in any particular form, just a great flood of light. Produces a sense of solidarity between the experiencer and the universe, which gives the experiencer a sense of the basic all-rightness of the universe, an understanding of such a phrase as occurs in the book of Job, "Yea, though he slay me, yet will I trust in him," which is, seems to me, a characteristic feature of the mystical experience. And this kind of experience, the experience of the same
order with a revolution, the conscious awareness of the mind of the meta-universe, as well as adding their productions into the mind of the whole. And this is called, when you have that, this is called the light. It's called mystical or high creative experience. And then you design a process that enables the cosmos to be recreated in its entirety.
Who are we? What is man? What is human nature? If it includes these strange faculties, which I think it does, then human beings are a great deal odder than we ordinarily suppose.
Subtle bodily engineering, a relationship so accepted and working towards understanding that what was once the clay body becomes an occult seed from which flowers emerge as a gift of the demand of being.
You're also, are you not, Mr. Huxley, very much interested in extrasensory perception, in telepathy, clairvoyance, precognition, and so on?
Yes, I've always taken an interest in that. I sometimes go down to Duke to see Dr. J.B. Rhine there, and I'm a great friend with Mrs. Garrett, who runs the Parapsychology Foundation here.
And all of you are starting to rethink what it is to be human, what it is to be We on this side of the veil are greatly pleased. You go back through eons in this work, dear one. It is not new to you by any means, and somewhere in your heart you are deeply aware of this. Somewhere in your heart you know that the study of the esoteric is, has been, will be of eternal importance to you. It is the core of your being. You have been engaged in this study through many lifetimes and indeed in many realities. You may begin to consider yourself a thing of an expert, dear one, but don't let it go to your head, all right?
Do you think it's possible for people to have an awareness of what is happening in other people's minds, in the outside world, or in advance of the thing happening?
Well, it seems to, I must say. I think the evidence collected is very convincing. I can't see that one can reject it. I don't happen to have these gifts myself, but I've seen people who have.
Do you believe in survival after death?
Yes, I think I do. I think there is a survival after death. Again, there may be reincarnation, I don't know. I think it's exceedingly difficult to say what the evidence from psychical research means. It does seem to mean that there is some sort of a survival of some element of personality anyhow. And
I suppose that because time and space doesn't exist for him, he may have already seen the film. And I would like to know if he's thought about it or what he thought about the film.
He is aware. He has seen what you have done. He sends his congratulations primarily.
I am not believing.
He says,
it is a dramatization of possible contact outside time and space, done more or less convincingly, performed by the Chandler's unconscious mind. Or is it?
They've tried to control the fall of dice by thought. Is this
yes,
true?
Yes, this is the main series of experiments they've done. We've had this crap game going on for about 20 years now. It seems to have a statistical validity.
There is necessarily truth here, but it is a truth that is so unparticular that it is like the sky, the drop of dice, or the most telling moment when our own physiology ends and the chaos and creativity of our shared reality begins. When and where our voices speak us and thoughts conceive us.
In a slightly different dimension or a slightly different vibration, another film was created. There are hundreds of them out there. There are hundreds of them. It would not be possible for us to view each and every one, but we will tell you generally that the quality is quite high on almost all of them. There are one or two rather shoddy final products, dear one.
In March of 1963, when I was just barely out of my teens, I woke up to a phone call from a friend. Aldous Huxley wants to meet you. Me? What? Me? And I couldn't figure out why, except that I had the only legal supply of LSD in New York City.
We have to explore the inner world as well as the outer world. I mean, it's quite clear that if we remain fixed as behaviorists solely on the outer world, we miss half the essence of life.
The most audacious form of Huxley's escapism. Mysticism as a means to that escapism was reasonably honorable. But that he should now arrive at drugs, I find rather scandalous. encouraged by the persuasive recommendations of the famous author, many young Englishmen, especially Americans, will try the experiment. An irresponsible book.
Inasmuch as it permits, under suitable research conditions, the exploration of the stranger and odder areas of the human mind. I mean, this is one of the things which has emerged, I think, in recent years. Not only is the material universe incomparably larger and stranger than we used to give it any credit for, but the mental universe is also larger and stranger than we give it credit for, that we carry about inside our skulls an extraordinary world, a visionary world, a mystical world, and that the interesting fact about these substances is that they open a door and permit us, without doing any harm to ourselves, because this is the most extraordinary fact about these new drugs, without doing physiological harm, to explore this world. From a sociological point of view, obviously these drugs can't be used. But at the same time, I mean, I think sooner or later we shall have to find some kind of substitute for the permitted drug, which is alcohol.
His books on psychedelic experience, Heaven and Hell, Doors of Deception, as well as the recent utopian novel, Violent, had become a virtual scripture for me. And even so, I was quite unprepared when I opened my door to discover a man who looked like one of William Blake's archangels, or perhaps the average man from the distant but optimal future. Very tall, very beautiful, with eyes misted over by near blindness. He seemed to be gazing into other worlds. He had the most sensitive face I have ever seen. And when we sat down to talk, the most sensitive mind as well. And what a voice, those bell-like tones, that modulation, but that extraordinary richness of sound. His words wrapped around your mind. He was also courteous to a fault. Someone had given me a 6-foot panda for Christmas, which I had propped up in a chair in the living room. Because his vision was so poor, and because he was so courteous, Aldous Huxley would address remarks to me and then to the panda. I had not the heart to tell him the truth about the silent guest.
In 1967, the Beatles, while being questioned by a girl with kaleidoscope eyes, as plasticine porters with looking glass ties glowed as if there were no tomorrow, paid homage to the philosopher grandfather of the psychedelic movement by pasting his image onto their album cover, Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Heart Club Band.
The Beatles made taking drugs seem an enjoyable, fashionable, and liberating experience. Like them, with the help of LSD, you would see and feel in ways you hadn't imagined possible. The collective crash was just around the corner, but for today, what was to be learned from such heights was not to be denied by the abuses and nightmares of the day after. The view of utopia is always a reflection on the retina while seeing the panorama of the end of the world. Utopia and the end of the world, a twirling, spinning coin on its edge, careening at catastrophic speeds. Only through the power of sorcery can one discern the figures of the world eternally about to settle and be defined by the inscriptions of a mythic power. The other kingdom.
You've been called a salesman for mescaline.
But this is a very strange drug, of course. The peyote is this cactus which grows in northern Mexico and Texas and has been used from time immemorial by the Indians of the Southwest. And incidentally, it's come up into Canada now, the use of it. It's become a kind of symbol of cultural nationalism among the Indians. And there's even a Christian version of the peyote religion called the Native American Church, which is spreading up north. And it's undoubtedly a very interesting and strange and important drug. And of course, what they've done now, they synthesized it, and they have now another drug, lysergic acid, which produces almost identical effects and produces in most people this transfiguration of the outer world, that everything seems more real and intense and beautiful. And with people who are good visualizers, It produces visionary experiences with the eyes closed. And then it also, I mean, the Indians seem to take it for two reasons, partly to get into this visionary world, and partly to get this sense of solidarity with the other members of the religion. And with the solidarity with the world in general, it produces what may be called a kind of pre-mystical or even a mystical experience.
Do you advocate it, as I understand you have, as a sort of substitute for alcohol, as a means for escape?
Well, no, not as in its present form, but I mean, I think probably, again, this we can look forward to. I would think that probably within 50 years, pharmacology will have discovered a much more satisfactory substitute for alcohol.
Looking at flowers in the psychedelic state. In his two books of reflections on the mescaline experiences, we see how his experience of three ordinary flowers flung open the doors of his already stupendous perceptions into the very heart of the universe. He asked me to read to him the relevant passage from the Doors of Perception. I brought the much marked book from my shelves, and I read something of the following, where he wrote, "I was seeing what Adam had seen on the morning of his creation, the miracle, moment by moment, of naked existence. It was a bunch of flowers shining with their own inner light, and all but quivering under the pressure of the significance with which they were charged. A transient that was yet eternal life, a perpetual perishing that was at the same time pure being, a bundle of minute, unique particulars in which, by some unspeakable and yet self-evident paradox, was to be seen the divine source of all existence." Huxley followed my words with his blind eyes, as if he were back in that experience of pure being. He indicated I should go on. A repeated flow from beauty to heightened beauty, from deeper to ever deeper meaning. Words like grace and transfiguration came to my mind, and this, of course, was what, among other things, they stood for. The beatific vision, sat, chit, ananda, being, awareness, bliss. For the first time, I understood.
Himself. We don't have to wait for eternity necessarily. It is possible to become ourselves in the fullest ego-transcending form, even in this life.
Flowers met in the mind's antipodes. And he said, of course.
Most of it is the old weary dance of abstractions named not self, eternity, mind at large, suchness. The absolute, etc., etc., etc.
Well, anything can be used badly. But these particular things, I think, could be used in an extremely valuable way. As they stand, they are not for general use, because they just throw people out for too long a time, but they are capable of enlarging people's minds and of making them discover who and what they are. They are real tools for helping to obey the Socratic injunction, know thyself.
On November 22nd, 1963, the same day that John F. Kennedy was assassinated,
Pop.
Aldous Huxley died.
Ill with cancer, Huxley was on his deathbed when he used LSD for the final time.
And with the aid of what he termed the Moksha medicine.
Yeah, LSD 25.
Right. He liberated himself from his body while his wife Laura whispered from the Tibetan book of death and liberation into his ear.
Will you do that when I die?
I think we are capable of looking at the world as Spinoza said, under the aspect of eternity, in a kind of timeless way, perceiving things, so to speak, as they are, not through the veil of our concepts and notions about them.
Huxley reached the final dispensation.
Blankness to blankness.
No. Patterns, purpose, physics.
Oh.
The whole space-phase mindset of Newton is passé. Quantum mechanics changed all that.
Okay, so, cut to the bottom line.
Okay.
Cut to the chase, what do you mean?
Well, facts do not cease to exist because we ignore them. It's like this. The present can only exist because of the observer stopping the endless quantum possibilities by observing, or as we say, watching the present events unfolding. You've heard of the Copenhagen interpretation?
Vaguely. Matter is potentiality. That's what the world is. A probable description of many possible alternatives. But with each opportunity that causes the wave function to collapse.
There's the subatomic particle.
If you want to get technical about it. A small part of the universe is made real.
So I conclude with a poem by a compatriot of his, who I think spoke to Aldous when he wrote the words. This is Christopher Fry. The human heart can go to the lengths of God. If you don't like God, substitute emerging evolutionary process. The human heart can go to the lengths of God. Dark and cold we may be, but this is no winter now. The frozen misery of centuries cracks, breaks, begins to move. The thunder is the thunder of the flood, the flow, the upstart spring. Thank God, our time is now. When wrong comes up to meet us everywhere, never to leave us till we take the longest stride of soul folk ever took. Affairs are now soul-sized. The enterprise is exploration into God. What are you making for? It takes so many thousand years to wake. But will you wake? For pity's sake. Aldous Huxley woke up. We must do the same. Thank you.
limits of our capacities, to become what we potentially are. We don't have to wait for eternity. It is possible to become ourselves in the fullest ego-transcending form, even in this life.